Article 21 rights, access to health, sanitation. So it's rather unfortunate that that's been the government's response to this.
One thing which I forgot to say, which is not related to the questions, I mean, in my talk. You see, one of the issues that has a very interesting issue has come up before the International Criminal Court recently, that the refoulement of refugees like the Rohingyas amounts to a crime against humanity for which you can try that country in the International Criminal Court. So unfortunately, India has not signed that ICC treaty or that Rome Statute, as it is called. We must get, I mean, every civilized country should sign that treaty. Why shouldn't crimes be tried? If there is a dictatorship in place, or if the domestic judicial system has collapsed, as a result of which people who have committed crimes against humanity or committed crimes of genocide are not being able to be tried in their own countries, at least there should be an international fora, the International Criminal Court, where they should be permitted to be tried. So India should sign that treaty. And I'm glad that this issue has been taken up, that this refoulement amounts to a crime against humanity for which that country can be punished by the International Criminal Court.
So we're going to wrap up, and how many questions are there? There's one more. Okay, so then we're going to close. We're not going to do the closing remarks. Then we'll just quickly take these three questions and wrap up. Okay, these are the last three. But
follow up for that. In this case, the government has strongly taken the stand of dualistic policies, and it's not looking to implement. And it doesn't seem to recognize 1951 convention. So if it strongly holds on to the dualistic policy, how far will it have effect on the judgment regarding the Rohingyas, even if it favors deportation, and what effect will it have on future cases?
Okay, I'll just take the other two also, then we can respond together. Fine. Yeah. No, you'll.
Hello, good evening. My name is Aditya, and my question is to both Dr. Ashwini Kumar and Prashant Bhushan, sir. So do you find any specific reason as to why the government is so persistent in actually deporting the Rohingya community? Because it is absurd to believe that the government would not understand its legal obligations under the constitutional mandate of Article 21. And as Ashwini Kumar, sir, pointed out, the aspect of India, you know, being a signatory to so many important international obligations and treaties, and if you have to discount the aspects of security, you know, threats and the burden sharing aspect, do you find there is any specific reason as to why the government is so persistent in this particular obligation? And taking to from what Dr. Kumar and Mr. Prashant Bhushan pointed out, that the argument of the government lacks legal merit because of the fact that they say, and as to what Ashwini Kumar sir pointed out, that even if you're not a part of the if you're not a signatory to the International Refugee Convention of 1951, you're still bound by the fact that Article 21 mandates that every individual of the, Article 21 is essentially human-centric. So do you find there is any specific logic as to why the government is so persistent in, you know, taking this case forward in a particular way?
Hi, my name is Kavita. I have an observation as well as a question. So basically, I'm from Assam, and I wanted to give a background on the illegal Bangladeshi migrants that we have. Unlike popular opinion, Assamese had a problem with Bangladeshis was not because of the religion they professed. It was more about how Assamese society is. Assamese society, for the record, is totally non-religious. We do not believe in outward expression of religion. But when a new breed of people came in after the creation of Bangladesh and even before that, there was a sea change, even in my lifetime, that is my lifetime of 30 odd years, I've seen a sea change in Assam. You see people being overtly religious, being very conscious about certain things. Assamese society is different, and that's why the backlash, and that's why we suffer 20 plus years of militancy in our state. Alpha, the creation of it, one of the major issues was the illegal Bangladeshis and the state's refusal to deal with it. If the handling of Rohingyas is an issue, and I believe it's an issue by the current government, the passing of IMDT was equally bad in law as well as for the people of Assam. When we're talking about refugees, I think refugees do not exist in isolation. They live and they are supposed to integrate in the society. For example, we're talking about migrants.
Sorry to cut you off. Yeah. Is there a question?
I want to know your opinion about it, about integration of refugees within a society. It was more of an observation than a question, but yes, I would be happy if you could share your thoughts on this.
Yes, but I think that is not the problem with monism or dualism. Like monism doesn't say that just because an international comes into existence, it is automatically binding on them. The difference is that once you become a party, you don't need an implementing legislation. That is what the dualism is generally. Otherwise, your obligation to become or not to become or express consent to an international treaty lies in both forms, both in dualism and monism. No international obligation comes without the express consent of a state, and that happens by becoming a party to it in both monism and dualism. The distinction is that in another case, you require an implementing legislation the way we follow in a dualist model. So the primary responsibility lies with the state in both the models to become or not to become a party. In this case, they have chosen not to become a party. So it does not have any obligations, whichever the model we follow. Hope I'm clear.
I am not competent to answer your question, but on the other question on why is the government doing so on Rohingyas, the answer is very obvious. I stated so. It's totally and 100% linked to this BJP ideology of communal polarization. The only one and only reason they don't intend to deport these people. This issue has been raised only and only for branding them as Muslim terrorists who are eating our resources. So Muslims, terrorists, therefore Muslims are terrorists, it just feeds into their whole rhetoric and their whole ideology and propaganda. So therefore, that is absolutely crystal clear to me that refugees, government knows that they pose no security threat. Government knows that there are many other, 20 times as many refugees in India already as there are Rohingyas, therefore there is no issue on that. The only and only concern for them is to somehow use this issue to further create this brand of Muslim terrorists, etc.
Just to quickly respond to the integration issue which you raised, it is obviously it's in everybody's interest that refugees, when they're here, they're integrated. Unfortunately, in India, integration is not possible simply because they don't have the right to work. They have very limited rights, which is access to primary education and access to some basic public health facilities. That's about it. So what happens is that you have like really educated like doctors and lawyers and journalists working in button factories and you know garment factories and basically in the informal sector. And in that kind of a climate, it's very difficult for any kind of integration to happen. If you want that integration to happen, you need to allow them to work. There has to be a policy where they're able to convert their degrees or use their sort of qualifications to find jobs here. But on the flip side, then there's a whole argument which somebody raised about economic arguments, and you're taking away people's sort of, you know, then you're competing in the local market and you're probably taking away other people's jobs. So it's a difficult sort of, you know, situation to handle. But yeah, integration cannot happen unless you allow them to, while they're in asylum at least, to lead the kind of life they were leading there. That's the only way they can integrate. Okay, thank you everybody. We're going to call that a wrap, and we were planning to do closing remarks, but I think we've done that several times during our responses. So I think that's about it. Thank you to the panelists and thank you to the audience. Special note to the editorial board. I think you guys have done a phenomenal job in organizing this, and we've, on behalf of all the panelists, I would like to thank you because it was extremely, extremely well organized. So kudos to all of you.
We'd like to thank all the panelists for taking out time from their busy schedules for this wonderful discussion, and also to Ms. Roshni Shankar for so patiently and effectively moderating the session. We'll now be taking a break for 20 minutes for tea, and then we'll be recommencing the third session, which is on citizenship.
Our first panelist is Mr. Arijit Sen. Mr. Sen is a program manager at Amnesty International India, where he works and researches primarily in the areas of communal violence, under-trial prisoners' rights, and across human rights issues in general. He studied human rights law at SOAS University, London. He is a regular contributor to national as well as international media outlets. A large part of his work has focused on issues of migration and international refugees, with a special focus on the situation in India. Our second panelist is Ms. Leah Verghese. Ms. Verghese is a senior campaigner and researcher in criminal justice at Amnesty International India. She obtained a BA LLB honors degree from the National Law School of India University, Bangalore in 2005 and a Master of Public Administration degree from Columbia University, New York in 2014. Ms. Verghese has worked in several NGOs and political organizations in various capacities before joining Amnesty. Our third panelist is Dr. Harish B. Narsappa. Dr. Narsappa is a lawyer and founding partner of the law firm Samvad Partners. He is also the co-founder of Daksh, an organization geared towards ensuring better governance in India. He has a BA LLB honors degree from the National Law School of India University, Bangalore, a BCL from the University of Oxford, and a BA Philosophy from the University of London. Besides his vast experience in corporate law, he is interested in public law and has authored a book titled Rule of Law in India, A Quest for Reason. Our last panelist for this session, and as well as the moderator, is Mr. Alok Prasanna Kumar. Mr. Kumar is a senior resident fellow and head of Vidhi Center for Legal Policy, Bangalore. He holds a BA LLB honors degree from NLSIR University of Law, Hyderabad, and a BCL from the University of Oxford. He writes regularly for national daily periodicals and national and international academic journals on issues relating to the judiciary and Indian constitutional law and theory. He has written extensively on the Rohingya refugees issues and the approach to be taken by the Indian government and the Supreme Court of India. I now request Mr. Kumar to initiate the discussion.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the third session of the symposium on the issue, or at least the title of the session is Courting Issues of Citizenship. What we want to do with this session is broadly discuss two or three themes which we feel are relevant in this area. The first, of course, has to do with the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2016, which accelerates the citizenship process for refugees from certain neighboring countries on certain basis. why this particular bill has become a topic of discussion, what are the constitutional issues with this bill, and what are the what is the problematic approach that this bill takes towards citizenship is something that we propose to discuss. The second issue that we want to discuss here today is about the National Register of Citizens in Assam. For those of you who have been following the news, the process has been overseen by the Supreme Court for the last 4 years. A first draft of the National Register of Citizens, which states which of Assam's residents are citizens of India, was released earlier this year. And it was found out that about 4 million people, or about 40 lakh people, were out of that list. 40 lakh residents were out of that list. We are currently in the midst of the process where people who have been left out of the list can get back onto the list through a process. When I say it in those terms, it feels no different from, say, you know, filing your paying your electricity bill or giving in your admission form to school or college. But as we hope to discuss in this particular session, this is a process that is fraught with many pitfalls. It poses many difficulties for the people affected by it and raises some fundamental concerns about India's approach to citizenship in this respect. Not to say that none of this has any political context, it does, and we hope to discuss it to some extent in this session as well. The third aspect, which we want to somewhat go into, is not just to say this is what is wrong, this is what has happened, which is not right, and so on, but to acknowledge that India is going to have refugees come across the border. Almost every state which shares a border with India, whether a land border or a sea border, has had internal disturbances of some sort, ecological problems, and various other causes, which have led to people come to India without the necessary legal documentation. And we have come to India as refugees. The question, and we're going to be concerned with this issue again and again and again, how are we going to approach them? And it is fine to say at a very large level that it will be addressed on humanitarian concerns. At the end of the day, these humanitarian concerns will have to be translated through questions of law, through the state, through society, and how will we do that is something that we hope to touch upon in this debate. Very broadly, as you would have seen from the structure, each of us will speak for about 10 minutes on these issues or focusing on some aspect of these issues. We will then have a discussion among ourselves and on specific points for about 45 minutes. We can probably limit our discussion to about 30 minutes because there is a video which I think that we want Leah and Arijit to show on the, which Amnesty has prepared, which are on this issue, which we want to sort of play. And after that, I'll throw the floor open for questions, a question and answers on this particular issue, which we will try our best to answer, take the discussion forward. And we might conclude with about closing remarks for about 5 minutes for each of us. So on that note, let me lay down the context a little bit before I hand it over to the rest of my panelists. When we say citizenship, and I suppose a lot of you are law students, you have to understand it's a legal fiction. There is nothing which per se says, like when you see someone or when it's, there's nothing obvious about citizenship. It is a legal construct. The law says who is a citizen, who is not a citizen, and on what basis. We have to keep that in mind because although certain countries follow the principle that whoever is born here gets to automatically be a citizen of this country, not all countries do. And we have to also keep in mind, since the issue has also come up in the United States of America, where this is most famously followed, the reason for this principle was not that there was this inherent sense that this is how equality should be, but it was because post the US Civil War, when you needed to acknowledge the equality of African Americans who had been brought to the US for slavery, you had to acknowledge that it has to be birthright citizenship, that any other test will lead to a reversion and will lead to an undoing of the gains of the US Civil War in terms of civil rights. And that's a different context, but just to make the point that citizenship is almost always a matter of legal construct, which also means that this was one of the most hotly debated topics in the Constituent Assembly debates. It is discussed on multiple occasions across the 3 years in which the Constituent Assembly sat. It is one which saw the most heated debates. I don't want to go into the specifics of it because the issue changed, character when finally we realized that partition was inevitable, partition was going to happen. Then they realized that there was going to be a mass transfer of individuals between the two new dominions. And finally, by the time the constitution took shape, we have something like the clause in the constitution that we have, which relates to who will be a citizen, who will not be a citizen, and also addressing the interim period, during the time in which, you know, the partition took place and that violence took place and people, there was mass movement of people. And it is with very good reason that B.R. Ambedkar says in the Constituent Assembly debates that the clauses relating to citizenship took up probably the second most time in the Constituent Assembly debate, for debate, and before they finally arrived at the clause that is currently in our constitution as it stands. So there is a larger political reason for this. The larger political reason is not just because they were looking only at events within India. You will find that one of the interventions made during the course of the debate is by Sardar Vallabhai Patel, who says it's not just people of India who are watching how India resolves this issue of citizenship. It is people from around the world. Keep in mind the larger global context in which the Indian constitution was being drafted. You have just come out of the second world war, the second within the same generation.